Hi everyone, topic of the research work is piperine potentiate the cardioprotective activity of resveratrol against isoproterenol induced myocardial infarction. Cardiovascular diseases is a significant and ever-growing problem accounting for nearly one-third of all the deaths. Myocardial infarction, commonly known as heart attack, occurs due to the infrequent blood supply to the heart muscle causing the damage. There are number of modern medications available to treat myocardial infarctions but are associated with the side effects. Consequently, this issue has stimulated the interest in the use of natural products. Resveratrol is a polyphenol found in red wine, skin of red grapes, raw coca and peanuts, having the pharmacological activities such as anti-inflammatory, anti-cancerous, anti-diabetic, antioxidant and cardioprotective activity. Despite its cardioprotective properties, resveratrol has limited therapeutic impact due to its low in vivo bioavailability and rapid metabolism, which is the major barrier to converting its effect in humans. To overcome these limitations, we are combining it with the piperine, a nitrogenous substance which has well-established bioenhancer activity. Till now, no attempt has been made to study the combined effect of resveratrol and piperine on the cardioprotective functions, mainly myocardial infarctions. So we have grouped animals into four groups of six animals each: normal control, toxic control, resveratrol alone, and the combination of resveratrol and piperine for the 28 days. 24 hours after the last treatment, myocardial injury was induced by subcutaneous administration of isoproterenol 85 mg per kg. The effect of different treatment was evaluated by the percentage recovery in terms of heart rate and developed tension biomarkers, heart tissues and antioxidant levels. Combination of resveratrol and piperine demonstrated significant restoration of biomarkers, antioxidant, tension, heart rate compared to the resveratrol alone treated group. From the ECG studies, we found that disease has been induced and restored into the normal in the treatment groups. So we have also studied the effect on the serum cardiac marker enzymes. So from this we found that all the treatment groups such as resveratrol and the combination group of resveratrol and piperine showed a significant restoration of enzyme and biomarker concentration compared to the isoproterenol alone group. Among all the treatment groups, the strongest effect was found for the combination group of resveratrol and piperine. So we have also studied the effect on SOD catalase and thiobarbituric acid activities also. So we observed that the group treated with the combination of resveratrol and piperine showed a significant increase in both SOD and catalase compared to the resveratrol alone treated group. So from this we concluded that piperine, when co-administered with the resveratrol, significantly improved the cardiac complications by increasing its bioavailability and is effective in controlling the serum enzyme levels in the experimentally induced myocardial infarction in rats. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I am Shaheen, PhD scholar, Department of Pharmacology, NFIR, Deemed to be University, Mangalore, India. I am presenting on the topic of anti-obesity potential of Artocarpus heterophyllus leaf extract against cafeteria diet-induced obesity. As we know that obesity is a metabolic disorder that can lead to adverse metabolic effects on the blood pressure, cholesterol and insulin resistance and increase the risk of many other diseases such as cancer, diabetes and coronary heart disease. National Family Health Survey conducted in 2005 and 2006 indicate that the obesity has increased significantly in India. Treatment of obesity can indicate both lifestyle interventions or pharmacological therapy. At present, only two drugs used, that is sibutramine and orlistat, but both drugs have shown its own limitations and side effects. Hence, there is a greater demand in the search of new medicines. There is growing interest in the public for the traditional medicines for the potency and the lesser side effects. So India called as botanical garden because it has many plants which has medicinal properties. Our drug Artocarpus heterophyllus belongs to the family Moraceae, has a lot of medicinal properties such as antibacterial, antidiabetic and immunomodulatory effects. The objectives of my study include to evaluate the effect of Artocarpus heterophyllus in cafeteria-induced obesity in rats. Coming to the methodology, In the methodology, we have taken albino rats of either sex used for the study, and it is divided into 5 groups of 6 animals each. The group 1 is treated with the normal diet. The group 2 is cafeteria diet. Cafeteria diet is nothing but the combination of chocolate chips, cookies and butter flavored cookies. The group 3 is cafeteria and Orista 10 mg. The group 4 is cafeteria as well as our food drug of low dose. And the group 4 is cafeteria and the Artocarpus heterophyllus ethanolic extract of 4 mg. All the animals except group 1 induce obesity feeding diabetic cafeteria diet for the 6 weeks along with the treatment for other next 4 weeks. After that, the animal's blood will be collected and analyzed for the biomedical parameters such as blood glucose, lipid profile, the serum lipid profile, liver triglycerides and the locomotor activity will be evaluated. And coming to the result and discussion. In the phytochemical analysis, we found that the carbohydrates, glycoside, proteins, saponins, flavonoids as the phytocoestient. Out of these, some phytocoests such as saponin and the flavonoid have been noted for the anti-obesity nature. Our result demonstrated that the weight gain, which is significantly decreased by the treatment of Artocarpus heterophyllus in the dose-dependent manner, this is mainly because of the saponin, which has an anti-appetite depressant activity. The body weight was significantly decreased here. The serum biomarker levels such as low-density lipoproteins, cholesterol, triglycerides and the very low-density lipoproteins, liver TG level reduced significantly with increasing the level of high-density lipoproteins. And this is the increase in the high-density lipoproteins and decrease in the low-density lipoprotein indicates that these drugs will be used in the hypercholesterolemia. The combination of AHEE or our drugs and the standard Orlistat have shown significant increase in the locomotor activity. In the figure 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, it shows the decrease in the serum lipid level, serum glucose level and the weight of the liver as well as lipid profile level, and group 10, which increases the locomotor activities. The combining our result and discussion, we can conclude that the finding of the study suggests the Artocarpus heterophyllus ethanolic leaf extract is an appetitic suppressant and anti-obesity drug. The finding of the present study can be established clinically. These are my reference, and I'll extremely thankful to the principal and management of Srinivas College of Pharmacy and NFI Pharmacy College for my study. Thank you.
Hello everyone, I'm Tahreen Taj, Assistant Professor, Department of Pharmacology from NFI Pharmacy College and Research Center, Mangalore, India. The title of my study is Preclinical Evaluation of Hepatoprotective Activity of Bergeptin. Bergeptin is a phytoconstituent found in bergamot essential oil, citrus essential oil and in grapefruit juice having known antioxidant property. It shows useful activity in human body, also found to have an anti-inflammatory, anti-tumor and antibacterial action. Coming to the aims and objectives of the study, so to find out hepatoprotective activity of bergeptin by carbon tetrachloride induced liver by measuring SGPT, that is serum glutamate pyruvate transaminase, SGOT serum glutamate oxaloacetate transaminase, ALP alkaline phosphate and estimation of antioxidant superoxide dismutase and catalase. Coming to the materials and methods, here we have used Swiss albino mice, which is weighing around 25 to 30 grams of either sex were used. Phytoconstituent bergeptin was administered orally to animals by using oral feeding needle, and dose selection was performed according to OECD 423 guidelines. Here we have done 5 groups, so each group consists of 6 animals. So first group of animals administered with normal saline, and group 2 animals was treated with toxic control, that is carbon tetrachloride. Group 3 animals was treated with bergeptin low dose 75 mg per kg and carbon tetrachloride, that is 2 mg per kg, and group 4 were treated with bergeptin high dose, that is 150 mg per kg and carbon tetrachloride, that is 2 mg per kg, and group 5 animals were treated with standard drug, that is silymarin 100 mg per kg. Followed by, animals were sacrificed to collect the sample to analyze levels of SGPT, ALP, SGOT, SOD and CAT. Coming to to the results and discussion, so effect of vergeptin on SGOT and SGPT, there was an extremely significant increase in SGPT and SGOT levels in toxic control when it is compared to the normal control. Here, standard silymarin, both the high dose and low dose of vergeptin showed significant decrease in SGPT and SGOT levels when it is compared to the toxic control. Coming to the effect of vergeptin on ALP, so here there was an extremely significant increase in ALP level in toxic control when it is compared to the normal control. Here, standard silymarin and both high dose and low dose of vergeptin showed significant decrease in ALP levels when it is compared to the toxic control. Coming to the effect of vergeptin on SOD and CAT, that is, in this model, the toxic control revealed an extremely significant decrease in SOD and CAT when it is compared to the normal control. And treatment with the silymarin, high dose and low dose of vergeptin showed extremely significant increase in catalases and SOD levels when it is compared to the toxic control. Coming to the conclusion, vergeptin statistically reduced increased levels of SGPT, SGOT, ALP in diseased animals, and vergeptin statistically increased reduced levels of SOD and CAT in diseased animals. These are my reference. Thank you.
Greetings of the day to all the dignitaries. I am Dr. R. Padmavathi, working as Associate Professor in Department of Pharmacology in G. Pillareddy College of Pharmacy, Hyderabad, India. So now I will be presenting the work done in our lab titled with Anti-Urolithiatic Potential of Peel and Seed of Punica Granatum and In Vitro Study. Urolithiasis is with growing prevalence affecting all age groups is posing a challenge to the medical world. Pumica granatum, having the common name of pomegranate, commonly available and reported to be rich in antioxidants. However, only seed portion is consumed, but the study shows that peel is rich in antioxidants compared to the seed. With the known fact that prevention is better than cure, natural remedies are safer than synthetic drugs, the present study was aimed to investigate anti-urolithiatic potential of aqueous extracts of peel and seed of Pumica granatum. As preliminary screening, anti-urolithiatic potential was done using in vitro turbidimetric method. Cystone, clinically proven Ayurvedic formulation for urolithiasis, was used as standard. Anti-urolithiatic activity was tested in terms of inhibition of calcium oxalate formation. The precipitate of calcium oxalate at 37 degrees centigrade and pH 6.8 has been studied by the measurement of turbidity at 620 nanometers in UV. And the results of this study shows that, as shown in these two figures, cystone standard drug has significantly inhibited the calcium oxalate crystal formation with the percentage inhibition of 80.83. And also, the aqueous extract of peel at the dose of 50 mg/mL. Has also significantly inhibited the crystal formation compared to the control at the with the percentage inhibition of 68.43. Similarly, the aqueous extract of seed at 50 mg/mL has also shown to inhibit the crystal formation with the percentage inhibition of 44.27. And also the combination of peel and seed. Has also inhibited the crystal formation with the percentage inhibition of 55.72. And the comparison between the peel and seed has shown that the peel has significantly inhibited crystal formation compared to the seed extract. So these observations conclude that the aqueous extract of peel exhibited more significant inhibition of calcium oxalate formation compared to the aqueous extract of seed. The present study suggests that consumption of juice of Pumica granatum could be effective in treating urolithiasis and also could minimize the progression of the stroke formation and damage to the kidneys. It also suggests that consumption of whole fruit juice could be more effective than seed juice alone in urolithiasis. So finally, I thank organizing committee for accepting the abstract and allowing me to present in the conference. Thank you.
Hey, my name is Gurpreet Kaur, PhD Research Scholar at Inder Kumar Gujarat, Punjab Technical University, Kapurthala. First and foremost, thank you for this kind of opportunity. Today, I'll share and present my research work in front of you. The title of my research work is to investigate the role of caffeic acid in the prevention of atherosclerosis in rats. Abstract called CPP312. To the beginning, introduction about the atherosclerosis. It is a Greek word that means accumulation of lipids that leads to blocking. Change in diet towards high-fat diet is a major risk factor for the cardiovascular diseases. According to WHO, 16.7 million people die each year by the CVDS. Next about my test drug, that is caffeic acid, found naturally in various plants, fruits, vegetables, and the important pharmacological activities, hypoglycemic agent, cardioprotective, antibacterial, anti-inflammatory, antioxidant, as well as anti-cancer. Three major objectives of my study. First one, to explore the role of caffeic acid in management of atherosclerosis. Second one, to study the effect of caffeic acid in biochemical antioxidant and other changes induced by the high fat diet. And the last one, to compare the effect of caffeic acid with standard drug. Next work plan. Total duration of my study is 30 days. After 30 days, I perform following parameters. I used adult Vistar rats for my study, weight 180 to 200 gram. The standard atorvastatin was dissolved in normal saline and the caffeic acid was dissolved in canola oil. The induction of atherosclerosis, the high-fat diet was administered to the rat for 30 days. The composition of high-fat diet was normal sodium, cholesterol, pig-lard and multivitamins. For the experimental studies, animals were divided into 6 groups. Each group contained 6 animals. First group, normals. Control group, normal so diet. Second group, atherogenic diet control group. Third group, atherogenic diet, low dose of caffeic acid 25 mg per kg. Fourth group, atherogenic diet, high dose of caffeic acid 50 mg per kg. Fifth group, normal so diet, high dose of caffeic acid 50 mg per kg. And sixth group, atherogenic diet, atorvastatin 5 mg per kg. Next and most important section is the result section. First, defect on the hematological parameters. The AD control group shows significant increase in cholesterol, VLD, LDL, AI intraglycerol levels as compared to normal saline, whereas the HDL levels significantly decrease in AD control groups as compared to the normal saline group. On the other hand, the caffeic acid 25 mg, 50 mg and atorvastatin 5 mg per kg shows significantly decrease in cholesterol, VLDL, LDL, AI and triglyceride levels as compared to the AD control groups, whereas the HDL level is significantly increased in caffeic acid 2 doses and atorvastatin group as compared to the AD control group. The results effects on biochemical parameters in plasma. The AST, ALT and LDH levels significantly increase in AD control groups as compared to the normal saline group, whereas the caffeic acid 2 doses and atorvastatin show significantly decrease in AST, LDH and ALT levels as compared to the AD control group. Defects on the tissue analysis. The GSHR levels significantly decrease in AD control groups as compared to the normal saline group, whereas the caffeic acid 2 doses 25 mg, 50 mg and atorvastatin group show significantly increase in GSH levels as compared to the AD control group, whereas the TVARS levels is significantly increase in AD control groups as compared to the normal saline group. On the other hand, the test drug caffeic acid 25 mg, 50 mg and atorvastatin show significantly decrease in TVARS levels as compared to AD control group. Defect on hemodynamic parameters. The AD control group shows significantly decrease in AP, MAPL level, whereas no significant elevation SAP, DAP and HR level as compared to the normal saline group, where on the other hand the test drug atorvastatin and the caffeic acid show significantly increase in MAPL, APL levels as compared to the AD control group, whereas its non-significant elevations were observed in SAP, DAP and HR levels as compared to the AD control group. And the percentage on aortic lessons, 88.6% aortic lessons were present in AD control groups, whereas the 36.2% aortic lessons reduction of aortic lessons in atorvastatin 5 mg per kg and 15.3% reduction of aortic lessons were observed in caffeic acid 25 mg per kg and 27.2% reduction in aortic lessons were observed in 50 mg per kg. All the observations, we observed that the caffeic acid dose 50 mg per kg is better effective than dose 25 mg per kg. We also observed that the caffeic acid dose 50 mg per kg shows slightly different result as compared to standard drug atorvastatin 5 mg per kg. And we conclude that the anti-atherogenic activity of caffeic acid is attributed to the production from the antioxidative stress and various enzymatic activities. Thank you.
Respected jury members, myself Rohana Tabassum, I would like to present my e-poster on the topic Evaluation of Efficacy of Topical Heparin as an Adjunct in the Treatment of Dental Space Infection. Heparin is well known for its anticoagulant action, but many research has proven that topical heparin gel also has anti-inflammatory action as well. So I conducted a short study in a dental setup. Objective of my study to compare the efficacy of topical heparin with NSAIDs as anti-inflammatory drug in localized extraoral swelling due to dental infection. Introduction. In every dental practice, on a very regular basis, encounter patients suffering from severe pain of short duration with the concomitant extraoral swelling, commonly occurring as a sequel of dental or periodontal infection and occasionally trauma to the oral facial region. The conventional treatment provided is mainly NSAIDs, that is non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug along with antibiotics. The conventional treatment generally takes several days to reduce the swelling and the associated discomfort. In the current scenario, it is imperative to identify and provide newer or additional therapies to reduce the patient's suffering. In this study, topical application of heparin is suggested to help reduce the extra oral swelling and associated discomfort more rapidly than the conventional treatment. Coming to the materials and methods, a total of 40 patients were selected and divided into two groups, control group and study group. In both the groups, conventional medication was given. But in the study group, topical heparin gel was added as an adjuvant therapy. Conventional medication are NSAIDs drugs, that is diclofenac sodium 50 mg, paracetamol 500 mg, given twice daily for 3 days. Antibiotic amoxicillin 500 mg, metronidazole 400 mg, given thrice daily for 5 days. Whereas in the study group, patients were also instructed to apply topical heparin gel to the localized area of extraoral swelling over the skin thrice daily. Both the groups were recalled on third day for the evaluation of extent of extraoral swelling. The maximum diameter is measured with graduated scale in millimeters. The measurement was done at the first visit and repeated on the second visit on third day. The data was tabulated and compared for percentage reduction in the extent of extraoral swelling. Coming to the results and discussion, the obtained patient data was statistically analyzed and was found that the mean of linear dimension of extraoral swelling on day 1 in control group, it was found to be 69.4 mm, whereas in study group, it was found to be 54.6 mm. On day 3, the mean value for swelling was 5.75 mm in the study group, while the same was 26.65 mm in the control group. The percentage reduction in swelling for study group was recorded as 90.6% and same was 62.4% in control group. So it was noticed that on day 3, percentage reduction in the linear extent of swelling was significantly higher in study group with a p-value of 0.005, which is highly significant. Coming to the conclusion, this topical application of heparin gel, owing to its anti-inflammatory properties, provides localized action at the site of swelling and inflammation, thereby providing faster resolution of swelling and inflammation by about 50% when compared to conventional medication of NSAIDs and antibiotics. The patient included in our study did not report of any adverse effect or any hypersensitivity reaction due to the use of topical heparin sodium gel. So it shall be imperative that further extensive clinical trial be conducted in large group of population to further evaluate the benefit of topical heparin sodium. This is the end of my presentation. I would like to acknowledge the cooperation and the clinical support extended by Dr. Syed Najibullah Husseini at Dr. Najib Dental Hospital, Hyderabad. Thank you so much. Respected jury members, myself Rohina Tabassum, I would like to present my e-poster on the topic evaluation of efficacy of topical heparin as an agent in the treatment of dental space infection. Heparin is well known for its anticoagulant action, but many research has proven that.
Good evening everyone, I am Radha Singh from MT Institute of Pharmacy, MT University, Lucknow campus, Uttar Pradesh, India. I am here to present my topic, which is on effect of levetiracetam in combination with phytochemical on lead induced neurotoxicity in drug repurposing strategy under the guidance of Professor Dr. Sunila Dhaneshwar ma'am. Introduction. Alzheimer's disease is the most common form of dementia and typically manifests through the progressive loss of episodic memory and cognitive functions. In-depth knowledge of disease pathology, it is necessary to facilitate the drug discovery through repositioning. As we all know that neuroinflammation is the basic hallmark of Alzheimer's disease, due to this strategy, levetiracetam and berberine were taken as for the study. Objective: to investigate the neuroprotective effect of combination of levetiracetam with phytochemical on lead acetate induced neurotoxicity. Material and method: 6 albino mice having age 20 to 30 gram were used for the study. 6 group consist of 5 animal each. Lead acetate were given 20 mg per kg IP route through all group except healthy control group for 7 days. After that, treatment was started, and after the treatment behavior parameter was performed, and after the behavior parameter, biochemical parameters also were estimated. Now, result and discussion. The first figure shows Morris water maze in which the parameter was evaluated is transfer latency time. According to the graph, here we can see that there is slightly decrease in the transfer latency time in test group and combination group, which means the memory retention in test group as compared to disease control group. The second figure shows the parameter was evaluated in number of entries in open arm and closed arm. According to the graph, here we can see that there is slightly decrease in the number of entries in closed arm, which indicates the memory impairment in mice, and when we compare to disease control group. The third graph shows the transfer latency in elevated plus maze, which here we can see that the combination drug shows highly significant in decrease in the transfer latency time when we compare to disease control group. The fourth figure shows that the spontaneous alternation in Y maze, in which we can see that there is slightly increase in the spontaneous alternation, which means the memory retention in mice when we compare to disease control group. Now the biochemical parameter. The first parameter was percentage inhibition of acetylcholinesterase enzyme. Here we can see that there is slightly increase in the acetylcholinesterase enzymes when we compare to disease control group. The second was GSH, in which the glutathione reductase level reduced in disease control group and slightly increased the level of GSH in test group as well as combination group. The last estimation was MD estimation, in which we can see that there is slightly decrease in the melanoaldehyde level when we compare to disease control group. Now the histopathology of brain. According to the figure, we can see that the disease control group, the figure number 2, in which inflammations were seen and disorganization of cells and degeneration occurs in the cells were clearly seen. But in the combination group, we can see, which is the last figure, we can see that there is organization of cells and degeneration of neurons were seen. Now the conclusion. Results revealed that berberine and combination had significant neuroprotective effect by decreasing the transfer latency time in Morris water maze as well as elevated plus maze, and increase the percentage alternation in Y maze. Both berberine and the combination drug has significantly increased the acetylcholinesterase enzyme and GSH level in brain and decrease the MDA level in brain when we compare to disease control group. Reduced neuronal damage was also confirmed by the histopathological report. The outcome of this study demonstrated that the combination drug can be considered as a potential candidate for the management of AD. These are the references and acknowledgement, and I am very grateful to Professor Dr. Sunila Dhaneshwar ma'am for their wonderful guidance, and MIT Institute of Pharmacy for providing me infrastructure and facilities to carry out this work. Thank you.
Greetings from JSS College of Pharmacy, Mysuru. Myself, Ms. Shilpa Palaksha. The topic is assessment of drug-related problems associated with intravenous administration in intensive care unit of a tertiary care hospital. The need of this particular research was developed, as we all understand that critical care units, where we use more of intravenous route of administration as the method of choice, as it has a potential benefits, as also it has immediate therapeutic action, and also this route is a preferred route whenever patients is critically ill. So lot of possible direct and negative side effects are also associated with IV drug administration, such as wrong dose, drug diluents or cross contamination. IV therapy is of course complex and it's error prone, and it requires strategy to reduce the risk of complications. Hence, this study was designed to identify drug related problems in intensive care units. The main objective of this study was to identify and assess the drug-related problems associated with IV drug administration in intensive care units of a tertiary care hospital. Inclusion criteria included the patients who were admitted into the ICUs and the patients who were above age 18, patients who were in ICU for more than 24 hours, but patients who did not accept to participate in the study are the patient or the patient representative who do not sign the informed consent form were excluded from the study. Inpatient case records of the patients submitted to the who are admitted into the intensive care units were reviewed on daily basis. The patients with who met the study criteria were included by obtaining the consent from the patient if they are conscious or legally acceptable representative, and drug related problems were identified, assessed, and it was documented in the data collection form. The identified DRPs were discussed with the healthcare professionals and the possible interventions were made. Collected data were categorized into the relevant assessment headings. Around 256 patients were enrolled into the study. In among 223 drug-related problems were identified. Majority were in the male patients. Five types of DRPs were identified according to the Hepler and Stand method. And majority of interventions which we did, so around 82% were accepted. The drug-related problems which were identified were adverse drug reactions, overdose, more common subtherapeutic dose, drug use without indication, drug interaction, drug duplication, and this comes under the classification. But something which does not come under the classification was grouped as others, which considered more with the administration errors like air bubble trap, overflow, improper frequency, low flow rate, and Y side drug incompatibility and improper duration of the antibiotics. The identified DRPs were 223. In among that, when the interventions were made to minimize the risk, more than 3/4 were accepted, and it was majorly accepted in the RICU. Conclude this about this study. Critical care units are potential for DRPs, so it should be identified at the earliest, can be done by both clinical pharmacy services and regular educational programs. Early detection helps minimizing the risk, and this also increases the safety and better outcome of the pharmacotherapy for critically ill patients and reduce the number of DRPs. I thank you.
Namaste everyone, I am Jalapa Pradhan, the presenting author. I am pursuing my PharmD at JSS College of Pharmacy, Mysuru, JSS Academy of Higher Education and Research. I am going to present my research finding titled Assessment of Patient Satisfaction, Outcome and Experience Measurements Among Patients Receiving General Anesthesia. The co-authors for this presentation are Ms. Spurti S. Murthy, Ms. Gardapati Arushi, Ms. C. Rozangpui, Mr. Mohan Krishna and Dr. Sriharsha Chalasani. General anesthesia is a reversible state of unconsciousness produced by the medication, where anesthetists maintain a certain level of unconsciousness which allows the surgery and treatment to be painless. It is accomplished by administration of combination of inhaled anesthetic gases such as halothane, isoflurane, desflurane, sevoflurane, intravenous drugs such as propofol, etomidate, midazolam, muscle relaxants such as succinylcholine, vecuronium, opioids such as fentanyl, morphine, etc. Patient satisfaction, it is an essential part of the quality management. So difference between the actual situation and patient's perception changes as the level of patient satisfaction also changes. Various questions have been developed and it is used to investigate the patient satisfaction with anesthesia, but none of them have been universally accepted as each of them have their own pros and cons. There is an increasing support for the use of patient-reported outcome measures and patient-reported experience measures in measuring the quality of care across all these areas to guide the service improvement. The objective of this study is to estimate overall patient satisfaction, outcomes, and experience with general anesthesia. So, materials and methods. This study was conducted in Department of Anesthesiology, JSS Hospital, Mysuru, and the study design was prospective questionnaire-based observational study. The study was conducted over a period of 6 months, and patients of either gender above 18 years were included, whereas non-consenting, non-cooperative and critical patients were excluded from the study. Drowsiness, severe pain at site of surgery, pain at anesthetic site injection, sore throat, thirst predicted the dissatisfaction with anesthesia services. Patient experienced drowsiness which was moderate, whereas majority of the patients did not experience drowsiness. Few patients experienced pain at site of surgery moderately and few experienced severe, whereas majority of them did not experience pain at site of surgery. Similarly, majority of the patients did not experience pain at site of anesthetic injection, whereas few experienced injection site pain moderately and few experienced injection site pain severely. Sore throat, again, majority of them did not experience sore throat, whereas few patients experienced sore throat moderately and severely. So the patients were highly satisfied from the study. The patient reported outcome shows high level of satisfaction with anesthesia care. Patients commonly reported pain to be the worst thing about their operation and followed by anxiety, where the incidence of accidental awareness during general anesthesia was found to be 5, that is 2.25%. Conclusion: discomfort after surgery is common despite of the anesthesia care. The patient reported outcomes, patient experience, patient satisfaction, all these domains provide a comprehensive assessment of quality of anesthesia care. I would like to thank Dr. T.M. Pramod Kumar, Principal JSS College of Pharmacy, Mysuru, and Office of JSS Academy of Higher Research for their constant support. Thank you.
Good morning to everyone. Myself Manjunath. My dissertation title is on evaluation of utilization of high-risk medications in critical care units of a tertiary care hospital. Generally, high-risk medications means it's a heightened risk of causing significant patient harm when they are used in error, although the mistakes may or may not be more common or devastating to the patients. And the objectives of the study like to assess the prescribing pattern of high-risk medications and their associated drug-related problems in the predictors critical care units. And this was a prospective intervention study conducted over a period of 9 months in the critical care units of JSS Hospital, Mysuru, and patients who were the study criteria were enrolled into the study. All the necessary data, including patient, socio-demographics, medication history, social history, diagnosis, medication details, adverse drug reactions and other drug-related problems were collected and analyzed. And I am following the ISMP list of high-risk medications in hospital formulary were used to identify the high-risk medications. And I am following a Hepler and standard classification was used to categorize the drug-related problems. The total enrolled patients was 315. In that, 206 were male patient and 109 were female patient. And age subset analysis, in the age of 60 to 69, there is 77 patients, followed by 50 to 59, there is a 62 patient. And frequency of high-risk medication, patient who are receiving 3 high-risk medication per prescription is 134, followed by 1 high-risk medication per prescription is 108. And number of diagnosis is 1 diagnosis is 178, followed by 2 diagnosis is 73. And length of stay in critical care unit, that is 1 to 5 days is 219, followed by 6 to 10 days is 93. And frequency of drug-related problems, 1 drug-related problem per prescription is 111, 2
drug-related problems is 40, and distribution of drug-related problems across the critical care units, adverse drug reaction is showing more. In the coronary care unit, there is 27 adverse drug reactions we found, and intensive care unit 20, and followed by MICU is 16, and drug interactions is 25, followed by intensive care unit is 29, and medicine intensive care unit is 17, and casualty assessment of ADR, WHO scale and Naranjo scale. WHO scale, there is a probable ADR is 36 and possible ADR is 27, followed by Naranjo scale, 34 ADR is probable and 29 ADR is possible, and predictable and not predictable. 53.65 is predictable ADRs, and 6.35% is not predictable, and mild moderate severe. 52.38 is mild ADRs, and 46.03 is moderate ADR, and 1.58 is severe ADRs, and definitely preventable, probably preventable, and not preventable. 14.25% is definitely preventable, 38.09 is not preventable, and 47.62 is probably preventable. And predictors of the reported drug related problems: odds ratio is 95% is confidence interval, p-value less than 0.05, like 0.48 to 6.38 is significant, and rest all, it's all not significant. And high risk medication uses associated with the high risk of occurrence of drug related problems, and organizational culture that supports collaboration, education on safe high risk medication practices, programmatic high risk medications, policies and enhanced technology recommended to prevent drug related problems associated with the high risk medicines. Thank you.
Hello everyone, I am here to present my research finding on discrepancies occurred during multiple care transition process in a tertiary care teaching hospital, a prospective observational study. Emergency department, as we all know, it is overcrowded area with patients who are in dire need of immediate medical attention. Shorter duration of stay, incomplete data sources and miscommunication amongst healthcare professionals and with patients makes emergency department as hotspot for medication discrepancies. Those medication discrepancies can occur at various level of transition, such as during admission, transition from emergency to special ward, or from special to general wards, and during discharge. Still, very few studies have been conducted in Indian scenario. Hence, the main objective of this study is to identify the discrepancies occurred during multiple transition care points. The study was conducted for 6 months, from October 2019 to April 2020, there which patients admitted in the emergency department and shifted to other wards are followed up. Medication reconciliation at each step of transition was done, and discrepancies were documented by using descriptive statistics. Result: total of 165 patients were enrolled, out of which 79 patients had discrepancies. Total of 159 discrepancies were identified in those 79 patients. So here, out of those 159 discrepancies, the intentional discrepancies were 34% and unintentional discrepancies were 66%. And out of those, unintentional discrepancies were further classified into history error as well as reconciliation error. So next, the discrepancies occurred during different transition care points. The main 47.17% were from special wards to general ward transition point, and followed by general ward to discharge, 32.08%, which is shown in table 2. And the binomial logistic regression showed that age, duration of stay, number of medication and comorbidities are predictor of discrepancies, which is shown in table 2. So in conclusion, emergency pharmacists led reconciliation, especially during transition from special ward to general ward, and a discharge will lead to early identification of discrepancies and prevent medication errors.
Namaste everyone, myself Dr. Ajay Kuswa, Associate Professor and Head, Department of Pharmacology at Amar Sahib Babaji Singh Jinnah Singh Memorial College of Pharmacy, Dehla, Roopad, Punjab. Today I am going to an e-post presentation abstract, CPP307, the title, Gold Nanoparticle Based Colorimetric Technology and Important Components in Developments of Diagnostic and Therapeutic in Healthcare System. Introductions. Nowadays, most widely studied field in science is nanotechnology, whose history dates back to the 9th century. The terms nanotechnology was used for the first time by the Richard Feynman in the year of 1959, which is considered to mark the beginning of modern nanotechnology. In general, nanotechnology can be defined as manipulations of materials at the atomic levels by combinations of engineering, chemical and biochemical approaches. Nanoparticles can be used in field of sensing probes, therapeutic agents and drug delivery system in biological and pharmaceutical applications. Point of care diagnostics are very much needed in the healthcare and other sectors. They uplift of quality of life by promising health in both developed and developing countries. This active area of research, when combined with the another dynamic parts of research like nanotechnology, produce existing results. Nanoparticles in nanotechnology play a crucial role in providing opportunities and has potential in development of a new age group of sensing tools. Gold nanoparticles based colorimetric methods are widely used in rapid sensitive and selective detections of analytes or target molecules. Characterization of these synthesized of gold nanoparticles is essential for their potential use in prophylaxis, diagnosis and treatment of the disease. Objectives: the aim of this review to the discuss an overview of emerging and understand the development of gold nanoparticle based colorimetric methods and its importance in used in diagnostic and therapeutic in healthcare system. Material method formation of gold nanoparticles. Commonly two methods are popular in formation of gold nanoparticle. First one is the Tukwitz Franks are the first ones who introduced the most commonly used synthetic methods of gold nanoparticle preparation in the year of 1951. Tukwitz methods follows the principle of redox reactions between gold and sodium citrate, which as results gave spare safe gold nanoparticle. Another general gold nanoparticle synthesis produced following of previous and results of done by the brush screen. In this method, sodium borohydrides is used to the two phase of metals. Salt reductions occurs only in the alkanoethanols act as a stabilizers. Method of functionalization gold nanoparticles preparations. Functionalizations means modification of gold nanoparticles surface by the doing its conjugation with target specific ligands, molecule that facilitate specific binding to the target analyte or molecules of interest. Most commonly three methods, namely physical absorptions, covalence binding and selective recognitions in use for the functionalized gold nanoparticle preparations. Results and discussions. Colorimetric detections strategy, one of the most commonly and popular use for the nanoparticles for the construction of colorimetric sensors. Most of gold nanoparticle based colorimetric assay followed by aggregations based strategy, which is further of categorized into the two categories depending on the means of analysis of gold nanoparticles. Accumulation mechanism like cross-linking and non-cross-linking method also, and describe target molecules which is to be the detected has specific chemical group which on reactions or physical and interactions with the gold nanoparticles can disturb or nanoparticle electronics and environmental causing it to the aggregate. Gold nanoparticle is reported as the best colorimetric probes in a point of care as it is a lead to the specific in additions to recognitions of desired analytes by many researchers. Whereas gold nanoparticle based colorimetric detections offers inexpensive uses of apparatus for the results, interpretation and produce of quick and reliable results. Gold nanoparticle based colorimetry application is more useful in the prophylaxis, diagnosis and treatment the healthcare are also. Conclusions, therefore gold nanoparticle based colorimetric biosensor have the capability to serve simple, easy and steadfast of techniques to enable and visual quantitative analysis. Acknowledgement, I am also thankful to our institute management committee for the providing us necessary facility for research, and I also thankful to the organizing committee of this conference for accepting abstract and give us opportunity to present of this poster. Thank you very much.
name is Navneet Kaur. I am student of M.Pharm in Amar Shaheed Baba Ajit Singh Jujhar Singh Memorial College of Pharmacy, Bella. I am pursuing my master's degree in pharmacology branch. First of all, I am very grateful to management committee of my college who provided me a chance to participate in e-conference held by RECOPS. And I am also very thankful to RECOPS management committee who have firstly accepted abstract of the poster and further give me a chance to present a poster. The title of poster is Development of HSD1 Inhibitors in Management of Environmental Toxins Induced Metabolic Syndrome. The abstract code of poster is CPP308. Metabolic syndrome refers to co-occurrence of several known cardiovascular risk factors including insulin resistance, obesity, atherogenic dyslipidemia, and hypertension. All these conditions are interrelated and share mediators, mechanism, and pathways. As metabolic syndrome is a group of many disorders, so there is a need to find such a target which is responsible for all such consequences. One such target is 11-beta-hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase enzyme. This enzyme facilitates the action of glucocorticoids and precipitate metabolic syndrome. So, inhibitor of this enzyme can become an appropriate treatment of metabolic syndrome. Compounds founded as inhibitors include natural as well as synthetic derivatives. Chemical constituents of licorice such as glycyrrhizic acid, glyceretinic acid and carbinoxylon possess the property to inhibit HSD1 enzyme. Vitamin A, amodine and Momotica cherentina also possess the property to inhibit this enzyme. Various synthetic compounds include rosiglitazone fibrates and azelsartan. Compounds from the class aryl sulfamide thiazoles include BVT2733 and PF915275. Other compounds from the class anilinothiazolones include AMG221. So the conclusion found from the study is that all the above developed compounds show reduction in glucose level, reduction in triglycerides, reduction in food intake as well as reduction in body weight. These all are important in controlling the disorder. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Metha. I am former research scholar in Amar Shaheed Baba Ajit Singh Jujhar Singh Memorial College of Pharmacy, Bela. Hey, my name is Metha. I am pharma research scholar in Amar Shaheed Baba Ajit Singh Jujhar Singh Memorial College of Pharmacy, Bela. First of all, I would like to thank the management committee for giving me a chance to present for a poster in RECOPS International e-conference on drug development 2021. The poster is entitled Metabolomics, a Precision Tool for Cancer Therapy. Cancers are one of the leading causes of death in the world. According to WHO, there were nearly 10 million deaths in 2022 due to cancer. Cancers are related to the diseases that are caused by disruption of normal cell growth and proliferation of abnormal cells. Nowadays, genomic profiling for tumor is used to classify tumor types for prognostic assessment and for therapeutic decisions. Metabolomics is a systematic study of unique chemical fingerprints that are closely associated with individual overall pathophysiology, and this tool helps in providing precision medicine as a promising application to reduce ADR. The main reason for the spread of cancer is due to the change in glucose, glutamine, and lipid metabolism, which can be understood by Warburg effect. The metabolomic study required a series of steps, that is sample collection, example urine, plasma, blood, tissue, and saliva, etc. The next step is acquisition of data, in which NMR and mass spectroscopy are used. third step is data processing by the use of partial least square method and artificial neural network. Lastly, the data is interpreted. Many studies use 13 carbon isotope to investigate the glucose pathway. Target metabolomics provide basic global profiles of large number of metabolites, but untarget metabolomics usually rely on narrow set of metabolomics. The literature survey has suggested that many studies were done to find the diagnostic and prognostic biomarker for disease. And the result found that tryptophan, phenylalanine, triglycerides, lactate, citrate were the targets affected during cancer progression that can be accessed in precision medicine. Secondly, many oncometabolites like fumarate, glutamine, lactate, and choline are also used as a target in finding the disease mechanism. As a conclusive remark, metabolomic technique has provided tremendous promises in disease mechanism and finding biomarker, etc. Researchers need to collaborate more closely with clinicians and academics in order to increase the accessibility of this technique. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Jueria. I'm a pharmacy graduate currently pursuing full-time PhD in Annapurna Pharmacy College, Karnataka, India. The topic for my e-poster is a case report on Klippel-Trenaunay syndrome with artery venous malformation. Klippel-Trenaunay syndrome, abbreviated as KTS, is a rare congenital disorder characterized by a triad of localized cutaneous capillary malformations, venous abnormalities, and limb hypertrophy involving soft tissue or bones. Diagnosis of Klippel-Trenaunay syndrome can be made by the presence of any two characteristics among the three features. The aim and objective of this clinical case report is to highlight the importance of use of appropriate imaging techniques to diagnose the disease. Case presentation: a 14-year-old girl presented with complaints of abdominal pain and recurrent episodes of moderate to excessive bleeding per rectum while passing stool since 8 days. Patient had similar complaints in the past and was treated for the same in a different hospital. In that hospital, colonoscopy along with banding was done. The child was stable after the procedure, after which per rectum bleeding started again after 3 days and was hence referred to a higher center. Patient is a known case of extensive congenital lymphatic malformation, hence has bilateral lower limb edema extending up to the level of thigh. On detailed physical examination, she had paler and blood pressure of 100/60 mmHg. Upon systemic examination, palpation showed diffuse tenderness over umbilical right and left lumbar region. Lab investigation and diagnosis: peripheral smear revealed normocytic normochromic anemia, thrombocytopenia, and leukopenia indicating pancytopenia. Other investigation included increased level of C-reactive protein, that is 16 mg per liter, D-dimer value of greater than 9999 nanogram per ml. Colonoscopy was done under sedation, which revealed post-endoscopic varicose band ligation induced ulceration and rectal varices with no active bleeding, and was provisionally diagnosed as rectal varices secondary to portal hypertension. Multiple hemangiomas were noted in both the lower limbs. Multiple arteriovenous malformation was seen. Telangiectatic vein was present, and petechia was seen over both the feet. CT venogram showed multiple dilated and tortuous veins in the subcutaneous and intramuscular plane of both lower limbs with filling up contrast in venous phase, which is suggestive of slow flow venous malformations. Hence, a final diagnosis of Klippel-Trenaunay syndrome with arteriovenous malformation was made. Figure 1 and 2 depicts both the lower limbs affected by varicose veins and hypertrophy of both the lower limbs involving soft tissues. Conservative management was done, which included packed red blood cell transfusion and platelet transfusion for pancytopenia, followed by folic acid and iron supplement. Tranexamic acid 500 mg 3 times a day to prevent bleeding, class 2 ebony stocking, and foam sclerotherapy for both the limbs to treat varicose veins. Patient's family was counseled regarding the condition of their child. The patient was hemodynamically stable and was discharged with advice to administer iron, zinc, and folic acid supplement. Coming to discussion part, KTS is often a progressive disorder with no cure. It may be misdiagnosed sometimes due to inappropriate clinical examination and unavailability of diagnostic tools. In this case, patient was treated only for the presenting symptoms in previous hospital, but upon recurrence, she was referred to a specialty hospital. CT venography was done, which exposed the presence of venous malformation and limb hypertrophy. Radiological imaging techniques such as X-ray study of lower limb bones, color Doppler of arteries and veins, magnetic resonance imaging, magnetic resonance angiography, catheter angiography can be considered. Ultrasound computerized tomography and MRI shows the presence of soft tissue hypertrophy in KTS and can also help in identifying vascular malformation. Thus, use of appropriate diagnostic techniques should be considered in all pediatric patients presenting with vascular anomalies to prevent complications arising with age progression. Conclusion: from this case report, we can conclude that healthcare specialists should perform thorough examination and diagnose the disease at the earliest in order to prevent potentially life-threatening complications associated with it. Acknowledgement. My sincere gratitude to all teaching staffs and PhD scholars of Enopia Pharmacy College for their guidance and support. I also thank the organizing committee of Rasselheimer College of Pharmaceutical Science for giving me the opportunity to present in an international e-conference. Thank you.